Blessed be the one holy and living God.
Glory to God forever and ever.
To the city of David with rejoicing. And when those who bore the ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed an ox and fattens. David danced before the Lord with all his might. David was girded with linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the trumpets. As the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, looked out the window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord. She despised him in her heart. They brought in the ark of the Lord and set it in its place, inside the tent that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offerings and offerings of well-being before the Lord. When David had finished offering the burnt offerings and the offerings of well-being, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts and distributed food among all the people, the whole multitude of Israel, both men and women, to each a cake of bread and a portion of meat and a cake of raisins. Then all the people went back to their homes. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
The Psalms appointed for today is Psalms 24. Let's pray it responsibly by half verse. The earth is God's and all that is in it.
The world and all who dwell therein.
For it is God who founded it upon the seas,
and made it firm upon the rivers of the deep.
Who can ascend the hill of the Most High?
And who can stand in God's holy place?
Those who have clean hands and a pure heart,
who have not pledged themselves to falsehood, nor sworn by the words of our Lord.
They shall receive a blessing from the Holy One,
and a just reward from the God of your salvation.
Such is the generation of those who seek God,
of those who seek your face, O God of Jacob.
Lift up your heads, O gates, lift them high, O everlasting doors,
and the one who reigns in glory shall come in.
Who is this who reigns in glory?
The Holy One, strong and mighty, the Holy One, mighty in battle.
Lift up your heads, O gates, lift them high, O everlasting doors,
and the one who reigns in glory shall come in.
Who is this who reigns in glory?
This is God, the God of hosts, who reigns in glory.
A reading from the letter to the Ephesians. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love, he destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will. To the praise of his glory and grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of trespasses according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things, according to his counsel and will, so that we who were the first to set our hope on Christ might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of the truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were marked with seal of promise of the Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance towards redemption of God's own people, to praise of his glory. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
King Herod heard of Jesus and his disciples, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead, and for this reason these powers are at work in him. But others said, it is Elijah. And others said, it is a prophet, like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For Herod himself had sent men who arrested John, bound him, and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to kill him. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and for the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests, and the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it. And he solemnly swore to her, whatever you ask me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom. She went out and said to her mother, what should I ask for? She replied, the head of John the Baptizer. Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. The king was deeply grieved, yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Amen. Please be seated. Well, I know from talking to other preachers, this is a week people don't want to preach. You know what the word gospel means? Anybody?
Good news.
It's good news, right? So, like, what is this? This seems to offer only bad news. John suffers for speaking the truth. His collect reminds us that we are called to rebuke vice, speak the truth, and patiently suffer for the truth's sake. Whew, he suffers. So here we have these grim details, this ruler who has no moral compass beyond his sense of honor. We meet a vengeful and amoral woman, and we meet her daughter, who seems to be going the same way. John's voice is silenced, his head is taken away, his disciples can only bury the body. This doesn't sound like good news. But I'm fired up about this passage. I gotta tell you, there's a lot of good news hiding in here. Mark is telling us who Jesus is, and along the way he tells us about God's power, this unstoppable power. To find that message in here, we need to go back to the beginning. It's easy to get stuck at the end of a reading as though that's the point, but here the point is in the beginning. Jesus is working miracles, and everybody is wondering about him. Is he a prophet? thought of a guilty man. Not only a guilty man, but a man who suspects that there's a power greater than him. So I honestly do feel sorry for Herod. You know, Herod is totally unequipped to be the person that God wants him to be. He's learned a lot from his father, who we know tried to kill Jesus in his infancy. He knows how to be brutal. He knows how to take what he wants. And he knows how to shut his ears and his eyes. He's living in a hell that only very powerful people get to know, where there's no barrier to their appetites, and they generate hatred and suspicion, and so they rightly live in fear. I would not trade with Herod. And Herod, he has this sense that John is onto something, right? He gets that John is righteous and holy, and he likes to listen to him. And I imagine that when he listened, there's some spark that stirs in him, some little memory of righteousness that wants to flame up. But really listening would mean following what he hears, and that would cost him more than he's willing to pay. First, he'd have to stand up to Herodias. He'd have to let go of her and send her away. And then he'd have to start changing how he treated his servants, how he treated his subjects. And the next thing you know, he'd probably lose his life. If he stops acting like a tyrant, somebody else is going to come in there and take his life. So he's got a lot to lose. Now, the scripture says that he's perplexed. And I think sometimes perplexity is a way of saying, I don't want to take this in. I hear you, but I really don't want to listen. I don't know if you ever had that feeling when what you feel is I'm confused, but it's really like there's static between me and what I'm hearing. And I call it confusion, or I call it complexity. So Herod, I think his perplexity is like that. He's doing what he can to damp down that spark, that ember. So he listens, and then he sends John back to his cell. He leaves John's message at the level of entertainment. For it to be more than that, he'd need to change his life. I don't know about you, but I can relate to that in-between place. I've been perplexed in my life. I like to read about God. I like to read about prayer. I like to read about holiness of life. And I do my little bit to live that way. But there are so many other things to think about. Providing for old age, for my community's future. Next thing you know, I'm kind of tangled up in money. I want to please people, and that can silence me. I don't kill people, but I kill thoughts that disturb me. I cut myself off from some voices that say things I don't want to hear, including inner voices. So I get perplexed. And maybe you get perplexed sometimes. Now, in the end, you know, Herod makes this stupid vow. Right? This is just a stupid setup vow. And then in his concern for his honor, he kills John. Imagine if he had said, Herodias says, give me the head of John the Baptist. And he says, oh, honey, you don't mean that. I can't go that far. That, in his culture, would be totally shame. He can't do it. So having done this stupid thing, he then silences his conscience entirely. And Herodias succeeds. It sounds like John's mission has failed. Sounds like bad news. But it's not, because the story is about God's power at work. John's mission may be at an end. John's part in God's mission may have ended, but John has not failed. God has not failed. Herodias has not won. John has been raised. Herod knows that what he did was a violation of God's will, and he believes that God has the power to overcome his actions to the point of raising the dead. It's not a comforting thought for him. And I too believe that God has the power to keep creating, even out of my worst actions and thoughts. The Holy Spirit keeps recycling our compost and turning it into something beautiful. Well, I guess it becomes compost, right? It starts out as something else. The Holy Spirit can't be ended or contained by anything I do or anything that a tyrant does. If I refuse to be part of that dance, then God will find another place to manifest. God won't lose. I might. God won't lose. Now, Jesus is not John raised from the dead. And he's not Elijah. He's the anointed one. He's the Messiah. He's himself in all his glory. And he's here, in us and with us. And the power that Jesus manifests is working throughout the world. So I want to encourage you to read the news like I'm reading this story. We can read the horrible middle, the ending, what we mostly get. And we can walk away saying, the powerful kill the righteous everywhere. And we can bury that broken body of our hope. But there's another way to read. For every prophet who's gunned down or hidden and tortured, somebody else rises up. That spirit of generosity and compassion just keeps coming up. Tyrants are real, and their power is horrible, and their injustice is intolerable, whether they dominate whole countries or just their families. But tyrants are also miserable. They're cut off from the source of life, and new life always comes up to challenge them. It's good news. Give thanks for John's witness. This week, no, John didn't change his message to stay safe. He wasn't perplexed. John knew who he was, and he knew what he was called to, and he knew that he wasn't the goal of his own preaching. He knew that he was one step on a larger road. So John won that contest with Herod. That's good news. And Jesus won when it looked like he had failed. Jesus won. And for generations since, people have been winning as martyrs die, as nameless people are violated and extinguished. The Spirit keeps rising. So pray this week that you might know who you are, that you might know whose you are, that you will not fall into perplexity. Pray for the courage to follow that call when the choices are hard and it would be easy to be perplexed. And pray to know Jesus and to know that power and that love. And I guarantee that if you do that, your life will be full and rich and true. May it be so. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We believe in one
God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and then became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and his Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
God has called us to be priests for all people. Let us offer to God the world's concerns. For the church, that we might be faithful, willing to serve, and constant in love, we pray for the diocese deputies to General Convention, the diocesan participants in the Episcopal Youth Event, all who minister at the Episcopal Church Center, St. Andrew's Church in the Bronx, summer camp programs of the diocese, Incarnation Conference Center and Camp, Episcopal Church Foundation, in the hopeful church cycle of prayer for the Valley Christian Church, for Michael, our presiding bishop,
for Andrew, Alan, and Mary, our bishops, for the people of the diocese of New York, and for all people.
For the leaders of this nation, all nations and communities,
that their decisions may be for the benefit of all.
For all who suffer in mind, body, or soul, including Ashley, Kristen, Annetta, Dorothy, Maddie, Bob, Donna, Helene, John, Thomas, Robert, Noelia, Delaney, Enid, Dwayne, Lorna, Paul, Susan, Timothy, Joe, Frank, Rob, Gary, Pam, Valerie, Ruth Lynn, Bonnie, Robert, Lorraine, Scott, Danya, Tommy, Ellen, Joe, Mary, Sherry, the Schmidt family, Helen, for those serving in our armed forces on active duty, Alicia, Ivor, Mike, Cheryl, Jeff, John, Caitlin, and Joseph. For those celebrating birthdays, Patty Anderson. For those celebrating baptismal anniversaries, and for those celebrating wedding anniversaries. And for all those affected by the COVID virus, natural disasters, and human violence,
that they may find healing and comfort with God.
For all who have died, especially Fran Beatty, Thomas Schmidt, Carl Formbeck, and Father Fred Droben on the third.
Third anniversary of his death. And for all grief, gather us together into your heavenly realm.
Lord, you have called us to serve you. Grant that we may walk in your presence, your love in our hearts, your truth in our minds, your strength in our wills, until at the end of our journey, we know the joy of our homecoming and the welcome of your embrace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins to God. God of all mercy,
we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done in our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
My brothers and sisters, the peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us share this peace as we say it again. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Praise
are yours at all times and in all places. places, our true and loving God. Through Jesus Christ, your eternal word, the wisdom from on high by whom you created all things. You laid the foundations of the world and enclosed the sea when it burst out from the womb. You brought forth all creatures of the earth and gave breath to humankind. Wondrous are you, Holy One of blessing. All you create is a sign of hope for our journey. And so, as the morning stars sing your praises, we join the heavenly beings and all creation as we shout with joy.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Glory and honor are yours, Creator of all. Your word has never been silent. You call the people to yourself as a light to the nations. You delivered them from bondage and led them to a land of promise. Of your grace, you gave Jesus to be human, to share our life, to proclaim the coming of your holy reign, and give himself for us, a fragrant offering. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, you have freed us from sin, brought us into your life, reconciled us to you, and restored us to the glory you intend for us. We thank you that on the night before he died for us, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his friends, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection and ascension, longing for Christ's coming in glory, and presenting to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, we acclaim you, O Christ.
Dying, you destroy our death. Rising, you restore our life. Christ Jesus, come in glory.
Send your Holy Spirit upon us, and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be to us the body and blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your Spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ, and in the fullness of time, gather us with all your people into the joy of our true eternal home. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we worship you, our God and Creator, in voices of unending praise.
Blessed are you, now and forever. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
O our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
We who are many are one body, but we all share in one bread.
Mm-hmm. Pray for those who can't be here. Faithful God, in the wonder of your wisdom and love, you fed your people in the wilderness with the bread of angels, and you sent Jesus to be the bread of life. Though those not present here cannot consume these gifts of bread and wine, we thank you that they have received the sacrament of Christ's presence, the forgiveness of sins, and all other benefits of Christ's passion. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we embody your desire and be renewed for your service, through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen. Amen.
How great
Let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another. And you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen.
Are there any announcements?
We are looking for volunteers to help with the tax sale. We still don't know exactly when it's going to be, but we're running a bit late, so hopefully we have lots of helpers.
I wish I'd known, I would have brought you all my stuff. When is it?
September, but we don't know if it's going to be the 18th or the following week.
Okay.
So we're trying to do that.
All right. Anything else? Okay, I want to say again what a delight it's been to be with you all and to see you looking well and still in church.
Thank you for being here with us.
Thank you.
And come back soon. If you're not up here, come back soon.
Thank you. Do we have any birthdays? Anniversaries. What?
July 3rd and July 4th.
Well, please. I promise not to get too close to you. That's great. Watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall, and in their hearts may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their lives, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Excellent. All right.
Can we say a prayer of travel for my mom? I don't know if she's on today, but she's
coming
here on Wednesday.
Okay. And her name is?
Carol.
Carol? All right. This is for you, Carol. Oh God, our Heavenly Father, whose glory fills the whole creation and whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, in particular Carol. Surround them with your loving care, protect them from every danger, and bring them in safety to their journey's end. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
You bet. All right. Live without fear. Your Creator has made you holy, has always protected you, and loves you as a mother. Go in peace to follow the good road, and may God's blessing be with you always.
Amen. Amen.